Genesis and creation in the wisdom literature, part one. This is on Job in particular. We've been talking about creation in the Old Testament. A couple of books, both edited by Gerald Klingbeil, the Genesis creation account and its reverberations in the Old Testament, and a more popularized version called He Spoke and It Was, Divine Creation in the Old Testament. And there's the covers for the two respective books. Today we're discussing chapter 7, part 1 in both books, Genesis and creation in the wisdom literature, and particularly the article by Ángel Rodríguez of the Biblical Research Institute on the book of Job. The introduction, of course, is the introduction to both parts, but that will give you an idea of how Rodriguez approaches this. In this study, we seek to investigate the presence and significance of creation motifs and or ideological elements found in Genesis 1 through 3 that may be present in the books of Job, Proverbs, and Ecclesiastes. This is basically an intertextual study. We will explore the biblical text in its final form. We will also examine the possible influences of ancient Near Eastern creation accounts on the wisdom literature, which in the case of Job, he's going to discount. Old Testament scholars generally recognize that wisdom thinking and theology are directly related to the topic of creation, and that creation provides a coherent perspective from which to study it by integrating wisdom thinking into the theology of the Old Testament. This direct connection between wisdom thinking and creation justifies example or influence of Genesis 1 through 3 on wisdom thinking. Intertextuality has been variously defined, but in this study, we will use it to designate the interrelationship between several texts intentionally established by the authors of the most recent text in order to communicate a message. It assumes that the linguistics of the text are rooted in the literature and culture of the writer, and that it contributes to the understanding of that body of literature. In order to set limits on the identification of intertextual references, it is necessary to find terminological and thematic connections between texts. In this study, we will be examining the theme of creation and terminology that connects passages from the wisdom literature with creation terminology predominantly found in Genesis 1 and 2. These markers will help us to identify possible quotes and allusions to the biblical creation narrative. We will begin our study with the book of Job and then move to Proverbs and Ecclesiastes, and we'll get to the latter next week. Creation motifs in the book of Job. It is generally recognized that the author of Job was acquainted with the creation account of Genesis and used it in the development of some of his arguments. The book contains a significant number of creation motifs and discussions. We will only examine some of the evidence and its possible connections with Genesis. Creation of humans. Although we do not find an anthropogony in Job, the writer is acquainted with the creation of humans as recorded in Genesis. Elihu, when arguing that often humans do not ask for help, God's help, states that, quote, no one says, where is God my maker? Osai, Job 35:10. The participle, Osai, the one who created me, is the call participle of the verb asa, that is to make, do, or create, which is the commonest verb for create in the Old Testament and is found in Genesis 1 as well. This is the same verb used in Genesis 1:26 when God said, let us make, asa, man in our image. Elihu is assuming that God is the creator of humankind. Job also uses the same participial form to refer to God as he who made us in Job 31:15. He refers to himself as the work, ma'aseh, of God's hands, Job 14:15, using a noun derived from the verb asah. The M at the beginning, or mem as it would be properly in Hebrew, is a formative verb that's used to turn a verb into a participle. This connection between the use of this verb in Job and in Genesis is strengthened by linking it to the breath of God and to clay. Now, Job sees God as a potter or artisan, your hands fashioned, asav, to shape form, and made me, asa, altogether. He proceeds to clarify that concept by saying, you have made, asa, me as clay, homer. The verbs asav, to fashion, and asa, to make, are used as synonyms to refer to God's act of creation. The asav stresses the artistic skill of a craftsman in making an idol. Job conceives of God as an artisan who shaped and created humans from clay. Clay is the raw material used by the potter to produce what is intended. When used with reference to God, it points to God's sovereignty and care for humans, as you can compare Jeremiah 18 or Isaiah 64. In the context of creation, homer is the raw material God uses to create humans. This term is not used in Genesis 1 and 2, but we find instead the phrase of dust, afar, from the ground, adamah, in Genesis 2:7. And yes, there's a connection between adamah and Adam, or Adam. In the book of Job, clay, or homer, and dust, afar, are practically used as synonyms in Job 10:9, and I'll quote that verse next. Humans dwell in houses of clay whose foundation is in the dust. And you can see the clear parallel there. When they die, they return to dust, according to 34:15, an idea explicitly found in Genesis 3:19. The conceptual connection is quite clear. The text, Job 10:9, is, remember, I beseech thee that thou hast made me as the clay, wilt thou bring me into dust again? And the implication that clay and dust are parallel words that are being used in a synonym here, partly synthetic and partly parallel, bit of poetry there. In Genesis, the movement from clay to a living human being occurs when God breathes into his nostrils, off the breath, nisma, of light, of life, haim. Actually, if I was translating that, it would be the breath of nismat, because nisma would be breath. This is also the case in Job. For as long as life is in me, literally, nismati be, or the breath, or I would say my breath is in me, and the breath, ruach, of God is in my nostrils, af, which, of course, the nostrils, it's the same term, af. The Hebrew term nesama, which is related to nisma, designates the divine gift of life bestowed to humans at creation, which constitutes the dynamic nature of human life that is sustained by the Spirit of God. The ruach of Eloah. They are both given to human beings as life-giving powers. When God withdraws both of them, the result is death. The book of Job presupposes that the writer knew about the anthropogony recorded in Genesis 2. There is some additional evidence that can be used to strengthen that conclusion. We will begin with Job 31:33. Job is speaking. Have I covered my transgressions like Adam by hiding my iniquity in my bosom? The only linguistic connection with Genesis is the term Adam, which could be a proper name or a collective noun for humankind. It's used in both ways in Genesis, early Genesis. This reference to Adam has been interpreted in different ways, but the most obvious one is to take it as referring to Adam. There is in the text a clear allusion to Adam's attempt to conceal his sin before the Lord by blaming Eve, or I would add, perhaps by hiding to begin with. The second passage is found in one of the speeches of Eliphaz, in which he asked Job, "Were you the first man to be born, Yalad, or were you brought forth before the hills?" Eliphaz is reacting to Job's attack against the wisdom of his friends. This passage deals with two different moments, existence and pre-existence. The first is about the moment when the first man was born or came into existence. The image of birth is used to speak about creation, even though technically, of course, creation was not birth. Before the hills, and the second takes us to the time before creation, before the hills were created. Was Job the first man created, or was he created before anything else? Here, Psalm 90, verse 2 could be useful. Before the mountains, Harim, were born, Yalad, which of course they didn't come out of a uterus, or you gave birth, Hill, to the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Now, we're not just picking any random psalm here, because this is a psalm of Moses, according to the superscript. So, this would be somebody who might have actually written the book of Job as well. So, using the mountains were born, Yalad is obviously not being used in a hyper-literal sense. This passage indicates that the verbs yalad and hil can be used figuratively to refer to the divine work of creation. In that case, the birth of the first man designates the creation of the first human being and would at least allude to Adam. One wonders whether Eliphaz is satirically asking Job whether he thinks he is wiser than the first man, or even than God himself. The possibility of the allusion to Adam is quite strong. The last passage that we will briefly examine is Job 24, 4 and 5, where Zophar asked Job, "Do you know this from old, from the establishment of man on earth?" Establishment being Sim, which we've seen before, and man, of course, being Adam. The biblical background for this statement is Genesis 2:8. The Lord planted a garden towards the east in Eden, and there he placed, Sim, the man, Adam, whom he had formed. The presence in Genesis 2:8 of the noun Adam and the verb Sim makes the connection between the two passages practically unquestionable. What Zophar is bringing to the table is traditional wisdom, which he pretends to be as old as Adam, and he marvels ironically that Job has not yet learned it. The alleged presence of other accounts. Some have found in Job 33:6 evidence of a non-biblical anthropogony of Mesopotamian origin. In the text, Elihu is addressing Job. "I belong to God like you. I too have been formed of the clay," karatz. It has been argued that in some myths dealing with the origin of humans, the Akkadian cognate verb karatsu, meaning to pinch off, takes as its object clay, which in the Akkadian is tida. In one of the myths, the goddess Mami, which I'm not sure exactly, because obviously it doesn't fit mummy in there, but Presumably, those are the signs that are used to indicate it. The goddess Mami nipped off 14 pieces of clay to create humans. In another one, two goddesses nip off pieces of clay from the Abzu, give them human form and place them in the womb of birth goddesses, where the clay figures develop and are later born as humans. Interestingly enough, in Genesis, Adam isn't put in the womb of anything. He's just formed and then breathed into. Based on this Akkadian mythology, it has been suggested that in Job we find at least traces of a myth that is significantly different from what is narrated in the Genesis account. One could perhaps give serious consideration to the previous interpretation if, first, it could be demonstrated that Elihu, coming from Uz and under the influence of Mesopotamian thinking, was not acquainted with the creation account found in Genesis. But this is not the case. In Job 33:3, as we have already pointed out, he uses ideas now recorded in Genesis 2:7 to refer to the origin of his life. God gave him the breath of life. Second, Elihu is attempting to answer some of the arguments used by Job to support his views. In chapter 13, Job argued that it appears to be impossible to enter into dialogue with God. Now, Elihu says to Job that since they are both humans, they can enter into dialogue with each other. They both were created from clay, Job 10:9 and 33:6, and God gave them the breath of life, shown in verses 27:3 and 33:4. In other words, their common humanity is traced to creation. Elihu seems to be developing an argument based on the creation narrative recorded in Genesis 1. Concerning the meaning of the verb karatz, the pu'al formation or the call passive, the translation to be nipped off is only assigned to its usage in Job 33:6. And this is done under the influence of the Akkadian cognate. There are four other uses in the qual formation in the Old Testament, in three of which its direct objects are the eyes. In such cases, the meaning seems to be to blink or squint the eye. Maybe Clint Eastwood style. The phrase refers to a nonverbal communication consisting of a gesture that could express mockery, deception, or indifference. In one case, the direct object is lips. He who compresses his lips brings evil to pass. In Proverbs 16:30. Probably referring to a gesture of disdain or deception. The Ugaritic cognate Hof Resh, Tsade, could also be useful in attempting to establish the meaning of the Hebrew word karatz. Like the Hebrew verb QRS has two slightly different meanings, meaning to nibble, to bite gently, or to gnaw and mold or to form. The first usage is compatible with passages in the Old Testament in which the verb karatz, when used in conjunction with the eyes or lips, means to wink or squint or to compress. The Ugaritic verb is also used with clay. Ugaritic thit, to express the idea of shaping it into an effigy. This usage fits quite well into the meaning of the Hebrew word in Job 33:6, justifying the translation formed out of the clay. Therefore, there is no need to postulate the presence of a Mesopotamian anthropogony or traces of it in Job. Creation and decreation. I'm going to skip over a little bit there. The prologue. It has been suggested that if we read Job 1 and 2 through the filter of Genesis 1 to 3, we will discover a correlation that is not accidental, but that is the result of a conscious adaptation of Genesis to the fabric of the new narrative. Only a few of the connections deserve consideration. Although the case is not as strong as one would like it to be, it could be argued that there seems to be an intertextual connection with Genesis. As described, the family and possessions of Job appear to be a fulfillment of God's command to Adam and Eve and to the animals to multiply and be fruitful. The blessing bestowed upon Adam and Eve has also been granted to Job. The creation narrative seems to create the atmosphere for the story of Job, who is described as living in an idyllic state. This is reinforced by the reference to a seven-day cycle in Genesis, which is implied in Job. Remember, the children feasted on each of the brothers in each of the brothers' houses in a cycle. Job's idyllic state of being changes in a radical way, and he experiences decreation. Having lost everything, he is left with only his wife. It is probable that the tragedy begins during the first day of the seven-day cycle, as his children celebrated in the eldest brother's house. This is when creation should begin. Job's first reaction to decreation is summarized in the sentence, "Naked came I from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return there." In Genesis 2, the human awareness of the nakedness surfaces at the moment when, on account of sin, decreation begins. Actually, in Genesis 3, that should be. Job is also realizing that he is heading towards death. The saying may be identifying the womb with the ground from which the humans were taken and to which they will return. We should mention one more theological connection between the prologue of Job and Genesis 3. In both cases, we find an adversary, the serpent, the Satan. And it is the Satan, if you go back to the original, it's Ha-Satan. In dialogue with another person, God in Job and Eve in Genesis. But the fundamental attitude of the adversary is the same. The theological concept of a cosmic conflict is present in both. And the adversary's primary object of attack is not Eve or Job. It is God himself. In both cases, he attacks God's way of governing his creation. In the case of Eve and Adam, God is charged with restricting their self-expression and development by threatening them with death. In the case of Job, God is accused of having bought Job's service by protecting Job and his family. The Satan insinuates that if God would only withdraw that protection and stop being Job's provider, Job would be able to express himself and would break his relationship with God as Adam and Eve did. The creation account provides the background for the prologue of Job in order to emphasize the radical experience that Job went through. What he experienced was like the deconstruction of creation experienced by Adam and Eve, but with one difference. He was innocent. This made his experience more intriguing. Job's first speech. Some have found intertextual connections between Job 3 and the creation account in Genesis. It is argued that what we find in Job's first speech is a counter-cosmic incantation designed to reverse the stages of the creation of the day of his birth, which were thought to be essentially the same as the stages of the seven-day creation of the world. What Job is doing is expressing a death wish for himself and the entire creation, according to that one source. To support this connection, the following parallels have been identified. And notice that when Job starts out, "Let it be darkness," in Genesis 1:3, "Let there be light." Excuse me for a minute while these. "Let God not attend to it." And God divided the waters below the firmament from the waters and the waters above the firmament. That's kind of, well, okay, if you push it hard. "That night, let it not be counted in the days of the years." And then verse 14, "Let there be light to divide between the day and the night, and let them be signs for years." And then day five, those prepared to stir up Leviathan, and God created the great sea monsters. It's not precise, but it's somewhat parallel. Why did I not die from the womb compared to let us make man? And then finally, for now I would be lying down and quiet. I would be asleep and at rest compared with, and God rested on the seventh day from all his work. He sanctified it because he had rested. Now, if the thematic connections are accepted, they would have to be interpreted in terms of reversal or decreation. But not all the parallels are persuasive. There is no valid parallel for day two. You may have noticed I mentioned that on the way through. And the third day is omitted. Overall, it could be argued that the creation account of Genesis 1:1 to 2:4 seems to provide the theological background for Job's first discourse, as he wishes for the impossible, the undoing of his creation. I'm not sure he wishes for the undoing of all creation, but certainly it could be argued that he wished for his own creation to be undone. This is particularly the case with respect to the phrase, may that day be darkness, yehi hosek. And by the way, it is yehi or in Genesis 1. Job 3:4, which is basically the opposite of what we find in Genesis 1:3, let there be light. But probably the most radical contrast is the one of rest. After creation, God rested to celebrate the goodness of creation. But Job wants to rest, nuach, check Exodus 20:11, which is, of course, the fourth commandment, and rested the seventh day. God wants to rest, Job wants to rest in death, denying the value, thus denying the value of his life. There are other linguistic parallels, like, for instance, days and years, Genesis 1:14 and Job 3:6, where the same words are used for days and years. Although, to be fair, that's the common usage of the words, the common words for days and years. And light and night, Lila and Or, in both Genesis 1:14 and Job 3:9. It may also be important to notice a reference in Job 2:13 to a period of 7 days and seven nights during which Job and his friends sat on the ground with no one speaking a word. This is a period of inactivity and deep silence, which is in contrast to Genesis 1, where God is active every day and his voice is constantly heard. It may also be useful to observe that Job's attempt to decreate his own existence takes place through the spoken word in the form of a curse, whereas God's creation takes place through the power of his spoken word that occasionally takes the form of a blessing. He blessed him and told him to be fruitful and multiply and so forth. The idea that, in using Genesis as a background for the expression of his emotions and wishes, Job is aiming at the decreation of the cosmos is foreign to the biblical text. But I think it's fair to say he probably did wish for his own decreation. Creation and God's speeches. The divine speeches in Job 38:1 and through 40 verse 5 are centered on the topic of creation as God takes Job in a cosmic tour. Decreation is not present in the text, but the Genesis creation account provides a background for the speeches. The first speech the Lord addresses to Job consists of dozens of questions about the cosmos. They begin with creation and advance in a pattern that approximates the first chapter of Genesis. Of course, God is describing creation to Job as he experiences it, and consequently we find comments on the presence of God of death on earth. This is possible because the speeches are not primarily about the creation of the earth and all that is in it. They are not even about the creation as it came from the hands of the Creator. This is creation as Job encountered it and as we encounter it today. But the speeches presuppose that God is the Creator, and this idea does go back to Genesis. The first speech can be divided into two sections. The first one is mainly about the earth, the sea, and stars, and meteorological phenomena. The second part is about the fauna, the animals, birds, and whatever. The speech begins with a reference to the moment when God is creating the earth. A building image is used for the divine act of creating the earth, in which God is metaphorically described as the architect, the surveyor, and the engineer. This is not another creation narrative different from Genesis 1, but a metaphorical description of what we find in Genesis. It is the theological background of Genesis that allows for the use of the metaphor. In the immediate context of the founding of the earth by the Lord, the separation of the waters or sea from the earth is mentioned. In Job 38:10, God separates the earth from the sea by setting limits on the sea in order for it not to encroach on earth. As in Genesis, this is creation by separation. Besides, in the rest of the speech, as we will see, Genesis 1 plays an important role. The use of building metaphor emphasizes the wisdom and discernment required in its grand design, something that only God possesses. When we compare Job 38:4-38 with Genesis 1, we find a significant number of linguistic connections between the two passages. The following list summarizes the evidence. And you can see that the term Eretz, or earth, pops up a number of times. Yam, or sea. Yatsah, to come out. Boker, morning, or light. Tahom, interestingly, appears in both places. Hosep, darkness. Yom, day. Adam, human. Deshe, or grass or vegetation. Shemayim, the heavens. Mayim, waters. And finally, apar, or dust, is found in both places. The one that I'm most impressed with in that list is tahom, because it's not a terribly common word. These linguistic connections are, to some extent, to be expected in a speech about the natural world. But the fact that, within the speech itself, there's a clear reference to God's creative activity indicates that the biblical writer was using the creation account of Genesis as a theological background for the speech. As we've already indicated, God is depicted as the architect and builder who lays the foundation of the building, takes measures, and then finishes the project by placing the cornerstone. From that moment on, the speech assumes that God is the creator of everything in the cosmos. In this section, the speech is based on what God created during days 2, 3, and 4 of creation week. And I'm going to skip over some of this. Job could not anticipate what would come next in spite of his acquaintance with the creation narrative. This is referring to the fact that that it doesn't follow the creation narrative day 1, day 2, day 3, and day 4. The rest of the first speech and most of the second speech are based on days 5 and 6 of the creation account and concentrate on the fauna or zoology. And again, it does not follow a precise chronological reading of Genesis 1. The speeches presuppose the creation narrative of birds and animals as recorded in Genesis 1, but it provides much more information concerning the habitat of the animals and their behavior. The main purpose for using Genesis as a point of reference in the speeches is to provide for them an organizational pattern, back and forth movement of the activities of day 5 and 6. In other words, without Genesis 1 as a reference, the long list taken from the natural world does not reflect any particular order or pattern. And even with that, it doesn't have a strict pattern. The summary: our discussion has provided enough biblical evidence to suggest that what the book of Job says about creation is influenced by the creation account of Genesis. This is particularly the case with respect to the origin of humans. The author and the speakers were well acquainted with the creation narrative and used it whenever necessary to contribute to the development of the dialogue. In Job, the account of the creation of humans is used as a rhetorical tool to communicate several ideas. The first is the obvious one. It is employed to demonstrate the common origin of humankind. Second, it highlights the fragility of human existence. Since life is fragile and brief, clay and breath, God should hasten to deliver Job from his pain or he will die. Third, it is used to underline the value of human life. Since human existence was created by God and is therefore good, the Creator should not destroy it. Finally, Genesis anthropogony is used in Job to accentuate the superiority of God as creator over humans as creatures. Now, I'm going to go through some of those texts that were quoted through, just so that you have, you know, a little more of a background there. Job 33:6, "Behold, I am according to thy wish in God's stead. I am also formed out of the clay." This is Elihu talking to Job. It highlights the fragility of human existence. So let's look at Job 7:7 and 21 and see how it relates to God should hasten to deliver Job from his pain or he would die. "Oh, remember me that my life is wind. Mine eye shall no more see good." And then 7:21, "And why dost thou not pardon my transgression and take away my iniquity? For now I shall sleep in the dust, and thou shalt seek me in the morning, but I shall not be." It is used to underline the value of human life. Since human existence was created by God and is therefore good, the Creator should not destroy it. And to compare, I'll give you chapter 10, verses 8 and 9. "Thine hands have made me and fashioned me together round about, yet thou dost destroy me. Remember, I beseech thee, that thou hast made me as the clay. Wilt thou bring me into the dust again?" You may remember seeing that other one. And then 27:3, "All the while my breath is in me, and the Spirit of God is in my nostrils." Human life is valuable. And then finally, Genesis anthropogony is used in Job to accentuate the superiority of God as creator over humans as creatures. And Job 31:14 and 15, "What then shall I do when God riseth up, and when he visiteth, what shall I answer him? Did not he that made me in the womb make him, and did not one fashion us in the womb?" And then 34 verse 13, and I'm sorry, this is, ignore that first word, it doesn't belong there. "Who hath given him a charge over the earth, or who hath disposed the whole world? If he set his heart upon man, if he gather himself his spirit and his breath, all flesh shall perish together, and man shall turn again unto dust." In the prologue, the idea of the decreation is influenced by the creation account and is used as a background for the reversal of Job's fortunes. It is also employed to connect the adversary in Job with the serpent in Genesis 3. Decreation theology is particularly present in the first full speech of Job in chapter 3. In the divine speeches, Genesis 1 not only contributes to the development of their ideology, but in some instances, it also contributes to the organization of some of their content. This presupposes that the author of Job was exceptionally well acquainted with the creation narrative. Now, my take on all this, it is difficult not to see from Job that both the characters and the author believe in some kind of creation. One can argue that this does not prove a Genesis 1 type creation, but the verbal similarities argue that something verbally similar to the Genesis account is being referenced. It seems unreasonable to dismiss these similarities while at the same time trying to introduce an Akkadian myth as background based on one verbal similarity, which may not even be a meaningful one. I'm not sure that Job can prove very much in the mathematical sense, but I do think it is suggestive. And I think that those who claim that there's no evidence of influence of Genesis on Job seem to me to be closing their eyes to the evidence. Fortunately, there are not that many of those anymore. Some of the strength of the opposing arguments seems to come from the known dates of the composition of Genesis and Job accounts. And, of course, that only works if the known dates are in fact, truly known. The documentary hypothesis of the Pentateuch, which puts the creation account very late, doesn't have a very good track record. It's pretty much being abandoned now, and at least the outlines that put the Genesis account, especially Genesis 1, quite late, that's being abandoned. Being a skeptic, of course, means never having to say you're sorry. Hopefully believers can live by a little better ethic than that, but that's my opinion, and now it's your turn. The what?
The second to the last comment that you had there, you were talking about abandonment. I didn't quite understand that.
The second from the last comment.
I think, or the third. I was thinking.
Well, let's go back and look at it, so maybe I can make it clearer.
Yeah, that's...
That one?
Yeah.
The documentary?
What do you mean by later? Doesn't have a good track record. Document hypothesis of Pentateuch.
The documentary hypothesis of the Pentateuch. Well, if you had gone to graduate school probably 50 years ago, you have been taught with some certainty that... Genesis 2 is part of the great, and Genesis 3 is part of the great Yahwistic story. But the Genesis 1 was in fact written somewhere either near or after the exile, probably after, and was first seen after the exile in public. Probably after the return from the exile, in fact.
What would be their basis for that? Just a difference in style?
A difference in style is one thing. And also, if I understood the argument for the theory correctly, it was that Genesis 1 was very highly polished, which is recognized by virtually everybody who reads it. It reads very classically. And you can't just do that right off the bat. It takes a long time to polish off a story like that.
Could it be that it was more of a word of mouth thing that held on longer than the rest of it?
Well, I mean, you can propose all kinds of theories behind it. There's another set of arguments that go there. One of them is that anything that has the miraculous has to be sometime after the event portrayed, because the miraculous is something that would have to have grown up, you know, as a legend around the original stories, because really there is no such thing as a miraculous. And so, for example, the Exodus stories need to be considerably later than Moses, because you need time for those miraculous events to have kind of grown up, or time for details about them to have grown up to where they could have been recorded with a little closer to a straight face, because they really weren't miraculous to begin with. There was another thing, and that is that the theology of the Old Testament is envisioned as gradually getting better and better and better. And, for example, the resurrection of the just is taken as a very late phenomenon. And so books that have a hints about the resurrection would have to be late. And for example, Daniel, which they would have dated as about 164 BC, more or less. One of the latest books of the Old Testament from their point of view. And because Daniel does talk about the resurrection in Daniel 12. And that meant that Job needed to be late too, because it talks about the resurrection. You know, it's kind of brief. It's not a major theme of it, but it's clearly there. And that means, of course, any passages in Isaiah that talk about the resurrection have to be late. Ezekiel and the dry bones is kind of a hint of resurrection as well. But Ezekiel is known to be post-exilic, so that's not a problem. So what's happening is that they are putting both what they would consider mature theological ideas and miracle stories late. And so anything that has them has to be put late. And of course, the Genesis creation account is flat out miracle all the way through.
Well, I got one more question.
Sure.
As far as the whole outlook of what you've read here, there's a lot of theologians that believe that Job is way older than Genesis. In that, the Genesis that Moses rolled out for everybody to see. Now, if that's true, that means that Job would have more influence over Genesis than Genesis would have over Job. And we would actually be getting this information different than they did, because they would have already known about Job when they first read Moses' account of Genesis, which would give the whole thing a different meaning.
That is correct. There are people who would make that case.
But if
in which case, by the way, the whole idea of theologically sophisticated, therefore late, collapses, because Job has Satan and God arguing in a kind of like great controversy-like theme. And that must be very early.
And also
the concept of the resurrection must be very early as well then.
You get a context for the serpent also.
Yeah.
If Job was first.
The other possibility is that Moses collected records for Genesis. And there's some pretty good evidence that that might be the case. And if that's the case, then Genesis 1 and maybe even 2 and 3 could be older than Job, even though, as we have it written today, you know, put into the canonical book of Genesis, which presumably was written by Moses, that the actual writing down of it in the book of Genesis is later, that the stories themselves go back further, and in which case finding verbal similarities may indicate that the story of Genesis was, at least in some circles, widespread, and one of them was Job and his friends.
Well, there would be a lot of word of mouth culture back then, since, you know, their writing wasn't quite as prolific way back.
Yeah.
Lots of people gathering around the fire every night, talking about these things. You would think that maybe after some generations or so, there might be some slippage as far as accuracy goes. but maybe not, because they may have had a system of remembering this stuff correctly. And I don't know, it's just hard to see. It's just hard to see exactly what was happening back there to get all this information correct.
Well, you know, I'm old enough to have noticed a change in the ethos of conservative Christian society myself. When I was growing up, one of the things that we were encouraged to do was to commit passages of Scripture to memory. It was helped by the fact that they were all in the King James, which meant that it didn't vary. You know, nowadays the question is, if you're going to do that, well, which version are you going to memorize? And you'd almost want to go back to Greek or the Hebrew to do that kind of stuff. But for example, you know, I can still quote to you the full Ten Commandments as given in Exodus. You know, I can quote you 1 Corinthians 13 right off the top of my head. That was something that was done. Nowadays, I don't know of too many places where that kind of thing is encouraged.
I remember that time. It drove me crazy.
But I mean, you know, what everyone's belief in that system was, or thoughts about its value, it was a different time, and it was a time when people did, in fact, put those kinds of things to memory and learned them. And that's not happening now. To illustrate another thing that's happening, I mean, because nowadays you can just look it up. To illustrate something else that's happening that doesn't have anything to do with the Bible itself, I can do quite a bit of math in my head. My kids, who are probably close to equally smart as me, maybe some of them smarter, can't do that stuff, because we have calculators and nobody learns how to, you know, how to add and subtract in quite the same way as we used to. It's becoming a lost art. And that's just in the last little bit. If you can imagine what it would be like when there was no printing. You learned it, and you learned it right the first time.
That's right.
Yes, and then over here.
These men live much longer than we do today. Maybe you didn't have to memorize.
Well, I think you still have to memorize, but it may have been easier if you had more time to do it. And
well, sometimes maybe they were just capable of reading it and pretty well retaining it.
And there are people whose memory is just absolutely phenomenal.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. I didn't want to pass up the opportunity, and I wished he had discussed the parallel between Job 38:9 and Genesis 1, verses 1 and 2. It seems to me that this elucidates so many things in terms of cosmology that it's too bad it wasn't mentioned. You know, Job 39 says, "When I made the clouds its garment and thick darkness its swaddling band." The fact that God here speaking takes time to mention this particular situation tells you it's probably not just a trivial thing, but originally here was an earth that had this garment of clouds and a swaddling band, which tends to enforce the model that the earth was here before, and it was dark, as described in Genesis, and helps you solve a little bit. Otherwise, this is not an easy question to answer, but I think it helps along the line that maybe on the fourth day, what happened was that cloud cover was lifted completely, so you could see the planets. but they existed long before that. It fits that model very well, and the parallel is interesting that we have a dark earth here at the beginning, before God starts any creating activities on verse 3 of Genesis 1. So the parallel is there, but it's, of course, it's not complete.
Yeah. Well, one can find hints, I think, in various places, and they may be valuable. Unfortunately, in poetry, one has to be a little bit careful about pushing things too far. But I agree with you that that there are some interesting implications for the early part of creation, particularly the part before birds and animals there, that should be paid attention to.
You know, and in verse 7 it says, when the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy, does imply that there were some organisms here before creation week, since they were there to sing.
Yeah, it's interesting to notice the difference between Ángel Rodríguez in his approach and Richard Davidson. Davidson seems to be at least acquainted with some of the scientific, theological controversies and try to interact with them. Rodríguez seems to just ignore that end of those questions completely. It doesn't seem to interest him for whatever reason.
You can't cover everything.
Well, you can't. That's true. You can't cover everything. And yet, ask yourself, what was the point that Rodríguez was driving at? You know, and what were the points that that Davidson was driving at? And appreciating, you know, some of the theological controversies, Rodríguez seems to be reacting to those primarily who think that Genesis and Job have no correlation with each other, or if they do have any correlation, it's kind of a vague cultural interest in how we came to be, rather than, and what he's pointing out is that Job and Genesis do seem to have some fairly specific parallels that suggest that the writer of Job knew about Genesis, or vice versa. And if it was vice versa, it's easier for me to envision somebody taking something concrete and then diffusing it out than for somebody to take something diffuse and then try to make it concrete.
Dick Davidson's been on Santa Barbara geoscience field conferences, and that may have altered his focus a little bit from Angles.
I mean, one of the things that I've been struck by is that theologians and scientists often have entirely different views of things and entirely different takes on things. And we were going over some chapters in the what's going to be the New Testament book, and the theologians blithely went through something, and the scientists, wait a minute, and didn't understand what was going on at all. Fortunately, I had followed at least some of the literature in the theological realm and realized what was at stake, but it's theologians oftentimes almost seem to live in their own world.
Of course, they think we live in ours too.
That's true. That's true. And in a sense, we do, because there's, if the scientists had read the theological literature, I think they would have realized where certain statements were coming from. But
I prefer the scientific world, of course. It does have some solid data once in a while.
Yeah, that's true. Well, my own preference is that really there should be more people who understand both. But, you know, that ideally you'd have people who are both well-trained theologically and well-trained scientifically. But those are hard animals to find. Anyway, we have another comment here, and maybe one more here, and then we'll kind of wrap things up.
Okay, you mentioned this theme of the fragility of human existence towards the end there, and also the value of human life. There's one verse in Job that always has really struck me, you know, just kind of jumps out at you, actually, too. And then his wife said to him, "Do you still hold fast to your integrity? Curse God and die." But he said to her, "You speak as one of the foolish women would speak. Shall we receive good from God, and shall we not receive evil?" In all this, Job did not sin with his lips. Now, what's interesting is that Job here is being tempted to despair, just as the author of Ecclesiastes, because of his suffering, just as the author of Ecclesiastes, all I don't want to jump the gun, is being tempted toward despair by his affluence, because he sees that nothing really means anything. And that impresses me with an underlying theme of creation, in that when I think of a creation, I think of God the creator, i.e. as sovereign, and man as the creature that is contingent. Now, touching on the present day, if God doesn't exist, then man is surely self-reliant, because who else is he going to rely on? But that doesn't follow from that that man is self-sufficient. Now, if you have self-sufficiency or a belief in it without self-reliant, the only end of that can possibly be despair. Now, to overcome despair nowadays, people come up with all sorts of distractions and inventions and things. So one can only wonder, when they run out of these distractions, which they eventually will because they'll no longer believe in them, then they'll be left with pure and naked despair, which sort of explains the nihilism that's under most of the prevailing godless worldviews.
I'm not sure I can add much to that.
What did you do?
No, I mean I agree. If there is no God, then what are we living for? God adds meaning to life. Now, that doesn't make the idea of God true, but it does suggest that before we toss out God, we should take a long, hard look at the evidence and see whether we really need to.
I haven't really known too many people, though, who live their lives as though life were meaningless. No, I mean, if they did, they would just be sitting and staring into space. So their behavior belies their professed belief. Does it not? I mean, they'll say that, "Oh, I don't believe in God, everything is meaningless," but they don't live that way.
Yeah. Well, if everything is meaningless, why don't you just give me your money? Because you don't need it anyway, it's meaningless.
Great idea.
Somehow that idea doesn't sell too well. Comment here. Did you have a comment yet?
Well, get off this varying theme, or maybe that won't be the case. I heard on the radio the other day that there was, I think, about an 8-year-old kid had run and memorized the entire Quran. Too bad it wasn't the Bible, but
yeah.
No Mozart could do that too. He could hear a tune.
No, and the other thing is that people who can memorize in those society are considered very, very important people, because they're like having a book. Only this time it's a book and a person all rolled into one. So people who have really good memories in a society that does not write things down are consulted like oracles. So you do have some selection for good memory in that situation. Anyway.
Yeah. Just in connection with our previous discussion, Ralph's comment, I quote this with caution because I don't have it exactly as it may be worded, but Alfred North Whitehead, very famous philosopher.
Mathematician.
Harvard and Cambridge, I mean, you don't come higher qualified than that. Makes a statement to the effect that scientists devoted to the purpose of showing that they are purposeless form an interesting topic of study.
There are truer words to that.
Well, again, that depends on how you define science. I think there's a better way of defining science. And in that way of defining science, I think that it does not automatically rule out a creator. And that's, I think that's one thing that we have to keep pounding on, is that there's different ways of describing it. One of them is science in one sense and science in another sense. One of them you might call true science, and the other one is scientific culture. So some people will call it the sociology of science. But whatever it is, there are two different things, and they're not identical. And that is how science should be done and how science, in fact, is being done at this time. But anyway, come back next week, and we will talk about the female god.